weather?
It's hot.
Yeah, yeah, it's pretty hot.
Thank you.
A, B, C, D.
Thank you.
Doing all of those things, I entered the narrator function. function. That is, much, though not all, of the game's emotional and intellectual content requires not knowing the rules, specifically that there are many sets, and figuring this out or not as you go. In the narrator function, I knew in advance not what would happen, but the framework that shaped its happening. Luckily, though, I was tasked with commenting more on the making of Heisenberg than on the piece itself. Knowing not very much, actually, about the making of Heisenberg, I took a wide view of what making might mean. So I'm going to use this time to follow a trail of texts, ideas, events, and non-events that led to your being here at the beginning of time, hoping that these considerations will suggest some things that you might be curious to hear more from Janani about during the Q&A. Does that sound good to everyone?
Yeah.
Great, yeah. I'll begin with some smaller formal considerations and find my way to some larger sociopolitical ones. Also, my talking points are going to move from longest to shortest, so don't worry. The smallest consideration, but one that looms large for me as something like a literary critic, is the question of who or what exactly I am inhabiting when I find myself in the narrator function. Is it God, Janani, Amelia Earhart, the laws of thermodynamics? There's this shift in pronouns that occurs early on in Heisenberg that makes the question of the narrator even more sort of pressing. The voice begins as an impersonal we who invites you into the game, and then rather quickly it becomes an I. That is, it quickly becomes personal. One thing Janani mentioned they found surprising about how the game tends to unfold is that even though in the beginning you are all invited to obey the instructions as you wish, most people, most of you, obeyed utterly. Either you forgot that you could do otherwise, or you did not wish to. Janani noted that even people who are very unusual in their everyday life, people who do not follow the usual social rules, follow the rules of the game. Janani thinks that this has something to do with how humans tend to react to new situations, but I wonder how much this has to do with the narrating I, experiencing power not as distant, an impersonal force, like code, computer code, social code, but instead as this like intensely intimate relation. But, okay, so that is already kind of a digression. The question I started with was, who or what is the narrator of Heisenberg? One answer is suggested by a text that, when we were talking, Jenny said they were reading at the time Heisenberg was solidifying in their imagination, Italo Calvino's collection of short stories called Cosmic Comics. So Calvino was a Cuban-Italian communist writer who spent World War II first secretly reading anti-fascist literature, then hiding from conscription, and then fighting as a member of the Italian resistance. Cosmic Comics was published later in the 1960s, and like Heisenberg, it uses scientific hypotheses, statements, and theories as an impetus for sort of playful but heartbreaking meditations on the problems, possibilities, and consequences of being in relation to each other. In Calvino's stories, the fact that the moon used to be closer to the Earth and is slowly being pushed away by the force of the tides, which the moon in turn creates. In his stories, this sort of fact is played out as a scene of a perfectly unreciprocated love triangle. Also in his stories, the Big Bang occurs because of an incredibly generous impulse, right? So like what happened when you all were like, I want more space. In these stories, what happens is somebody says, okay, I'm gonna give you more space, and then bam, the universe. I like to think that the narrator of these Calvino stories is also the narrator of Heisenberg. The narrator in these stories is giving this like absurd, unpronounceable name. It's spelled QFWFQ, Quifu. So this unpronounceable narrator, like Janani, guides us through the beginnings and ends of things. And though this unpronounceable narrator is not reliably or perhaps ever human, their sort of charming tour through the strangeness of the physical world helps readers see and bear the strangeness of the human one. The influence of Cosmic Comics on Heisenberg in turn leads to a set of questions about what it means to take the form of a literary object and turn it into a game that is meant to be embodied. So, as an example, over and over again in these stories, Calvino foregrounds the problem of trying to bring non-human phenomena into human scales. So, you have this unpronounceable narrator who's being, therefore, you as a reader can't quite grasp. You can't even say his name, so how are you going to figure out what he is, right? But this also happens in the stories in sort of anxious meta-statements about the ability of human technologies of simile and personification to convey utterly inhuman states. So to explain in these stories what it was like before the Big Bang, when all of matter was condensed into a single subatomic point, this narrator offers the literary image of being packed in like sardines. But then he immediately qualifies this by saying, in reality, there wasn't even space to pack us into. Every point of each of us coincided with every point of each of the others in a single point, which is where we all were. So in this way, Calvino, like a good pre-postmodernist, repeatedly is pointing to the failure of language to translate experience. But although Heisenberg uses similar techniques, the difference is that personification is much more literal. You're all actually invited to become the small stuff of the universe, which requires suspending, not foregrounding, this anxiety of translation, right? This is a personification brought out of a literary device and into a performance device. And I think that this is interesting, right? Suspending anxiety about incommensurability in order to make a game which is in a fundamental way about incommensurability. So, long thread cut very short, we might be curious together about the narrator, which leads us to a curiosity about the relationship between cosmocomics and Heisenberg, which might lead to a question for Janani about how they went about making an allegory come to life. What has to change in taking a textual experiment and making it an embodied experience? Okay, so that was consideration one. Consideration two continues the theme of movement across mediums, though this time what's moving is not a form, but an artist. I've known Janani for 6 or 7 years, something like that. When we first met, we were on a slam poetry team together. And then after that, Janani was one half of a nationally and internationally touring spoken word duo. And this means that for years, until now, their performance work has involved their body on stage. And as some of you might have noticed, in this work, Genevieve's body is noticeably absent. It is literally off to the sabbath. I think that the body of the maker is also a noticeable absence in Heisenberg when you put it alongside other kinds of similar performances. I don't play a lot of video games, so that means that my frame of reference for Heisenberg includes pieces like Marina Abramovich's Rhythm Zero. So this is a sort of famous performance art piece where the artist laid 72 objects out on a table, ranging from a piece of bread to a loaded gun, and instructed the audience to use them on her as desired. So right, you're invited to play this game to the extent that you will. This artist invited her sort of audience to use these objects as they desired. And famously in Rhythm Zero, things began quite peacefully and ended with someone holding the loaded gun to the artist's head, while other members of the public banded together to protect her from violence. So the kinds of chaos that unfold in both of these performances have quite different stakes. But at the same time, it's true that both Rhythm Zero and Heisenberg are interested in what the public will do given a set of conditions. Both of these pieces take the forms of games that attempt to figure the public out, though Rhythm Zero obviously is a game with many fewer rules. Another difference is that in Rhythm Zero, the maker's body becomes the object of the performance, is actually the situation, whereas in Heisenberg, the maker's body is nowhere to be found. When I asked them about this shift in medium, Jenny told me that after all those years on stage, they had grown weary of the dynamic that the audience-performer form tends to produce. They were tired of standing literally on a pedestal, being expected to be an authority, to be somehow fully formed, when for them, art-making is about exploration, fumbling, play. So rather than continuing to work in a way that led people to view them as an authority, they wanted to find an art practice that invited others to build a world with them. I wonder then if Genevieve's strategy and Abramovich's, the absenting of the body in favor of the voice and the presenting of the body with no voice, are two ways of managing the same problem, the problem of suspending authority long enough to draw the public who are used to keeping distance out and into the work, to actually become the work. If Jenny were to be playing the game alongside you, I wonder, would you have all behaved in the same way? Finally, consideration three. Heisenberg represents one response to the election of Donald Trump. Jenny dreamed it up 2 days after the election as they walked around in New York listening to people, presumably friends and strangers and journalists, expressing bewilderment about how such a thing had. Specifically, this is a bewilderment about what reality While inevitably much of our good, liberal, chattering class set out to understand, to bridge the gaps, Heisenberg begins from the premise that there are, in fact, fundamental limits to the precision with which we can know the realities of others, even though those realities run into, impinge on, and open up our own. Further, Heisenberg takes this incredibly, or perhaps pessimistic thesis, and makes it something generative and playful and silly. It builds a world. It asks how, knowing this, we might do and continue to live and move and dream alongside one another. In our conversations, Janani pointed out to me that the making of Heisenberg also accomplished these pedagogical aims, because in making the piece in collaboration with musicians and audio engineers, artists whose language Janani doesn't quite speak, it gave them a greater appreciation for how artists in other mediums think. But rather than setting out to learn these new languages, reducing the gap between all of these various makers, Janani learned to let go of the need to understand all pieces. That is, Heisenberg is the product of the kind of intimate collaboration it models, one premised on gaps in understanding. And just to close with another sort of anecdote, for a while, and maybe still, I hope still, Janani was making comics. Many comics that featured stick figures and were drawn in crayon. Mm-hmm. In one, which is incidentally the image I most associate with Janani, there are two stick figures standing underneath a yellow orange sun. One is in shorts and a sleeveless shirt, and the other is bundled in pants, a winter coat, scarf, and hat. Looking at each other, both figures seem slightly bewildered. The one in shorts says, "But it's not cold." The other one says nothing. Above the scene, it reads, "Please don't minimize my experience." I like to think that these two are friends, dear friends, who have hit upon their own uncertainty principle, coming to the realization that there is a sharp divergence in their experience, an inability to share assumptions about things seemingly as basic as temperature. Like Heisenberg, "Please don't minimize my experience" is a silly but very serious meditation on being together. And what the comment requests, the game teaches us how to do, to notice the innumerable ways in which we are not all playing by the same rules, and to live with the chaos, uncertainty, guilt, sadness, and delight that ensues. Perhaps even how to incorporate the knowledge of fundamental distances between us into the forms our intimacies take. So, that's what I got. Mm-hmm.
Being in college again for me because I was spending a lot of time in basements and pulling all-nighters.
Yeah, except this time with a bunch of musicians who are people for the most part I have not had such sort of intimate experiences with. Then we went into a sound studio to mix and master it. If you've not done mixing work before, it is the most painstaking surgery you can do to something. So yeah, I mean, this thing that it started out as this kind of like grandiose back of a napkin big idea, then came this tiny surgical crochet operation over time. But it was kind of great to see a project through. It was the most ambitious thing I've ever made, start to finish, because there were, you know, maybe 3 hours of voiceover to record in addition to all the music. I also, fun fact, did the voiceover when I was like feverishly ill, and without stopping. So Tina says, for that time, I turned into an android because I did not ask for food or water, and just for many hours. So that was a lot of fun. So maybe I embodied some of the experience of the output of part of the business. So yeah, that was a very chaotic and yet also ordered process of creating this work.
Hi, thank you.
Thank you.
You mentioned uncanic when you sort of described Heisenberg as a pedagogical experiment. And I wonder where you see this piece occurring in the world.
Can I tell you about some of my dreams of where I want this to occur?
Please.
I really want it to happen inside a Dillard's.
Amazing.
Yeah. Also an airplane hangar. Old airports. Or airfields, any places that are large and strange. It'd be really fun to do it in like a corporate office park, or just a skyscraper where you can't open the windows. I would also love to do it in museums of natural history, art museums in general. High schools, colleges, like places where people are also learning and engaging in that way. But I also just want to reach, audiences that aren't necessarily within the realm of contemporary art, and also those who are. So the answer is everywhere, as long as there is sufficient space and somewhere to put out some paper. If anyone knows, works at the Dillard's.
I don't know the exact dates for those yet.
So also thank you.
Thank you.
I'm a person who meditates every day. I'm reading Neil deGrasse Tyson's Astrophysicist for People in a Hurry. So this was like rocking my world for a lot of reasons. But I want to ask you a little bit about the five versions of the story. If you could talk a little, elaborate a little more on that, and kind of how that was created.
As in why I created the five versions, or how they were?
Well, both.
Well, I'm not going to tell you how they were different from one another, because I want you to talk to each other, because that's the other part of the game. Why I created five versions? I think that's just how many there were supposed to be of the game. When I imagined it, I was like, yeah, there are five tracks, and this is how we lay them down. I think the more painstaking task was trying to figure out how to allocate instructions within
timing.
A particular scene to the various tracks. Some of you within this game also have very special experiences that no one on any other track had, so if you find other people to talk to, you might find out what those things are.
I was just wondering what we cut off short of the robot voice near the end there. How can we hear the rest of it? What's the plan?
How can you hear the rest of Heisenberg?
Yeah.
I will at some point make a website full of all the future dates of Heisenberg. For now, you can get on my mailing list at sleepertrilogy.com. So sleeper is in someone who's sleeping, trilogy.com. You can sign up for my mailing list. It's for my other project, but Sure. So I'm primarily right now a writer of fiction. So Supertilly is the, so I just finished the first book of that. So that was a project I was working on for some time, somehow while creating Heisenberg. And my current project, I'm working on a book about an octopus and a psychic. I think, where does it fit in my larger project? I'm interested in making more work about how people exist alongside one another with dissonance, right? So I want to make more work that's about like paradox and uncertainty and weird things happening. And without a like neat package resolution, but also without necessarily like just a bundle of negative feelings. So I like making experiences that are challenging, but also hopefully delightful in some way, and joyful. So I think that's where I'm landing. I'm also, of course, very interested in exploring physics and astrophysics as a place to make work from. Right now I've been really interested in, I'm in this really cool residency where I'm paired with an astrophysicist at the planetarium who studies these objects that are kind of failed stars. Other people call them failed stars. They're called round dwarfs. And they're not quite stars, they're not quite planets. So I'm interested in also those middle things as like host sites or things we might think about as like actually future places for humanity.
In your ideal world, is the star perfectly synchronized, or do you want sort of like a spread of when people can play?
Well, I think part of making this very strange work in this medium that barely exists has been letting go of the perfect run, or the idea of the perfect run. Last time we ran it on the High Line, there was a thunderstorm and kind of gale force winds just up to the minute before we started, and we were basically inside a Faraday cage, so the radio waves that we were sending the audio through were all messed up. So I had to take a deep breath and remind myself that uncertainty is one of the things that I'm actually trying to grapple with. Hopefully, I can be okay with that for a moment and just let go of, you know, my perfectionism, which has been a very good and healthy process for me. So to me, I don't think there is an ideal world. The ideal world is that people who come to experience it have an experience and take something from it that they need.
Have we got time for one more question?
Do you have one? Do you ever think of curating the audience? Or the participants in some way, since it is this response to shared reality, putting the cold and the hot people together?
I would love to do it with all dinosaurs. I would also love to do it with an audience of like teenagers who are learning physics, which I think I can actually do at my friend's high school. I would also love to do it with people who are like loosely tied together in some way. Whether they work at the same organization or they're of the same profession, like a bunch of lawyers playing this game. I mean, it would also be beautiful with a bunch of dancers playing this game. It would be like a fearless experience and no one's ever watch it. I mean, all kinds of people. I think it would be really cool as like selected, curated groups of people. I also just love the randomness when everyone shows up. The last installment on the High Line, we had players. As young as I think like 8 years old. And they were honestly the best players. Because they're buried into every instruction. So kinetically, if you tell them to move very slowly, it's like this, they won't move a muscle. Perfect.
Thank you so much. This is part of the joy of curating is you get to make the festival you want. And all I've wanted is this kind of experience to have artists that I love and to have this kind of deep critical thinking, which usually is not admitted into the artistic conversation. And I'm so thankful for what you brought. This is what you're gonna get for the next couple of days. And if I can give you a little sort of teaser of how to navigate Prelude, we have workshops at the beginning of every day, and those workshops are in everything from intellectual property law to virtual reality production, prop making, and Kickstarter campaigns. They're free, everything's free.
We have works in progress by, again, artists that I'm thrilled by, and the idea is the juxtaposition of short samples of what they're working on and then a critical conversation across the three groups. We have How Did You Make That?, where I brought together different makers in the field, from producers to artists to people who run companies, where you, the audience, can ask the really practical questions of how did you do that and get a little bit of a better understanding of their craft. We have a fantastic panel with Danielle Alexander Jones on the legacy and the sort of networks of Black avant-garde performance, people of color avant-garde performance from its early histories to today. And another panel with Laura McNabb Cultural Council looking at where people make work. We've done a survey so that we can visualize where work is made in New York. So there's infographics, that's fun. And then these studio visits, which are sort of my, like I said, my own little personal joy, which was, can I create a space for artists to work, they all got to choose who their critical respondent was, and then for you all to have a little bit of a chance to enter into their process. So we have four more of those, two tomorrow night and two on Friday night. And then on Friday night, we close out by going to VR World around the corner, which is a virtual reality arcade and bar. So that's gonna happen. Free. It's usually like $50 for a couple of hours, and it's great, except don't do the bird thing, because I almost threw up. But come, it's gonna be fantastic, and I just have to say, from Kenster, what he has made, what the Segal Center has made, is a place where this kind of discourse, this kind of passionate engagement with art and scholarship can take place, and I don't think it's happening anywhere else so brilliantly, so thank you. And thank you all for coming.